Here we are, about to be 14 weeks into the Overwatch League's third season, and there are no undefeated teams remaining. Today we're talking about parity in the Overwatch League because of that. This is the first year where it really hasn't felt like a 2 or 3 team race. I mean, look at the standings. We have multiple teams with only one loss, and many of the others are in a realistic position to finish in the top 6 or 12. Sure, it's still early on and there is a real chance we see some separation sooner or later, but unlike the previous years, so many of these games feel totally unpredictable. There's two specific discussion points we're going to be talking about in this video that directly correlate with this, in my opinion. Those two factors are hero pools and the regular season being transitioned into a complete online environment with no LAN play whatsoever. Let's begin with the bigger thing first, because by now, I'm sure most of you have began to notice just how big of an impact the addition of hero pools is having on the league. There's no consistent meta to practice, so there is no world where you have those few teams who perfect how to play a particular comp to the point where they damn near flawlessly dismantle those who oppose them every single week. Sure, you'll see those certain teams consistently do well because of the level of talent they're working with, like your Shanghais and Phillies of the world, but it doesn't necessarily mean they'll be winning like 23 plus games this year. That level of domination we've seen in seasons 1 and 2 is so much less likely to be present with the current state of the league. It almost seems like this rock, paper, scissors battle, if you will. In one instance, a team might have the edge thanks to the meta being, let's say, deathball oriented, but then the very next week, they end up on the back foot because of slow-paced double shield comps. With teams only getting 1 week to prepare usually, there's only so much they can do to feel confident with the tools given to them. If some of the main heroes being utilized fall out of their comfort zone, or the team as a whole can't synergize well enough, then it could be a great struggle to win, even if their opponents are supposed to be weaker than them from a talent perspective. And it's not just the players who suffer from this whole situation. It goes without saying that it's pretty tough on the coaches as well. If anything, their lives are even more stressful. Back when we had a consistent meta, coaches mostly just had to work on the specific map strategies. With the meta constantly changing now, it makes their lives a whole lot harder. So much to prepare for with such little time on their hands. It doesn't help that up until recently, teams didn't even know who they'd be facing until 1 week in advance. There's only so much the coaches and players can do, and sometimes that can lead to their downfall. Now let's talk about some examples. The first one is going to be the Vancouver Titans. So in week 1, everybody was saying they'd be one of the best teams in the league, but then fast forward many weeks later and they go 0-2 in their first weekend back since the start of the year. Could you make the excuse that it was them failing to shake off the rust and them being stressed out over the drama they've been dealing with lately? Yeah, sure, I think that's totally fair. But I for one think it goes way beyond that. Look how they decided to play in their matchups with Chengdu and Guangzhou. In both instances, they were running stuff that really made you scratch your head. The big one has to come from the first day of week 10. They decided it would be a good idea to consistently run heavy dive compositions into a bunker-oriented meta. On control, this is something I'm completely fine with. From what I've observed, sometimes control serves as the outlier map that allows for you to get away with more, but the fact that they kept on living and dying by this comp after that map is just flat out alarming to me. And it only gets worse when looking at the healing combination they'd use with it. You're telling me you thought the play was Brig Zen? Like, in theory, I can see what the coaches saw in it. Brig provides armor to the flankers while also giving backup to the Zen, and Zen makes it easier to kill the dive targets. But in all honesty, I'm just not a fan of this healer combo unless there's a mirror match. There's not enough sustain. It lacks the burst healing to be extremely effective if your opponent is running something different from you. The charge could just sit back and expose them with heavy shield comps and things with high crowd control. It was way too easy. The Titans were at the mercy of the Guangzhou charge. Even when they tried switching it up, it was no use. It could not have been more obvious that the Titans were underprepared. As a result, the coaches tried building a game plan that played more up to the team's comfort zone. And let's call it how it is, they got exposed. On day 2 of that week, they started playing more normal stuff in their Hunters matchup, and they honestly did make it a competitive series. They even showed competence on Bunker. However, there were still moments where they tried to avoid double shield if at all possible. They really tried to keep bashing their heads against this imaginary wall with Rein Zarya. Rein Zarya Moira can be powerful. In fact, just 1 week before this match, it was quite prevalent in the meta. The only difference is that you could get the full death ball experience at that point in time thanks to Reaper and Sombra being available. Janu generally had a difficult time maintaining charge and dealing enough damage to charge up his Gravs quickly. All in all, it was a desperate plan to try and make up for Vancouver's inability to adjust, and yet again they suffered defeat because of it. I know it might not sound like the biggest deal in the world, but this was the first time Vancouver has gone on a losing streak in franchise history. Yes, you heard me right. This is the first time ever they lost more than one game consecutively. Distractions and internal issues aside, they did not play the correct heroes in a lot of instances, showing signs that they were either underprepared or not confident enough in their own abilities. How about another example? Let's move on from Vancouver. Let's take a look at the San Francisco Shock's Week 8 struggle with both teams residing in LA. So in this particular week, Orisa Sigma and Ryan Zarya were the popular tanks to run, and for some reason, like with the Titans, they seemed very reluctant to play Orisa Sigma. They seemed to be very set on running Ryan Zarya. When they tried playing Choi on Zarya, he instantly became the weak link on the team. Space was looking superior to him in the Zarya 1v1, and he really didn't look much better against McGravy in the Valiant game. What's weird is that the Shock were supposedly beating everybody that week in scrims, including the Valiant and Gladiator. But suddenly, during the official matches, they looked very lost. It doesn't help that they were keen on switching up their lineup so often either, and it's not like it was just a DPS like in the past. Every position was this game of musical chairs almost. I'm sorry, but this is just not a winning formula when you have such little time to prepare. If the players had another week or two, then maybe this would work out and it wouldn't have been as bad, but sometimes reality is harsh. That's not the world we're living in right now. What I find so bizarre about that week though is how the Shock refused to just play bunker at all. We have literally seen them win a championship with the Orisa Sigma tank combination, and it's not like their team went through any major changes during the offseason. Either Krusty completely dropped the ball on what should have been played, or he knew that his team needed more time to practice, so he had to improvise with his game plans for the week. It's so unlike the Shock to be underprepared. It goes to show that sometimes these sudden changes can even make the most talented teams in the league struggle to perform. For a third and final example of how hero pools can severely hinder a team's capabilities, let's take a look at the Seoul Dynasty. I know they aren't really a top tier team or anything right now, but they still did go from a solid looking team in their first week to getting 3-0'd by the Charge and Spark back to back. And I don't have to remind anybody that the Charge and Spark have been vastly inconsistent up until this point. The Spark, in fact, they literally just 3-0'd the week before, but then suddenly, the things that were working for them were no longer an option. It's not even funny how badly an Echo Sombra meta works out for them. It's no secret that Fitz was a very average Sombra player last year. People were saying the Dynasty looked better with Michelle on her, and he's a tank player. Prophet is probably the best Sombra player on the team, but sadly, the guy can't play two things at once. Not how it works. The Fitz thing alone is a big enough disadvantage as it is, but now you have to factor in all the other issues along with it. For one, Prophet for the first time in a while showed signs of weakness. A majority of the league's fanbase likes to think of him as a flex god who can literally pick up anything, but the fact of the matter remains was that his Echo performances last week did not live up to expectations. You'd expect him to make his presence felt even if the rest of his team didn't do all that hot, but that did not prove to be the case. So now Seoul is in a scenario where both of their DPS are not playing up to par with their counterparts, which ultimately led to guys like Eileen, Nero, Godspeed, and Adora getting the spotlight over them. But the nightmare doesn't end there. In general, Seoul's issues were definitely a team thing. They looked pretty lost out there, and the coordination was very off. There were numerous occasions where either Gesture or Prophet were getting picked off first. Gesture was either going in by himself, or Prophet was putting himself in these unfavorable positions. I'm not sure if the healers were tunnel visualing at times or something, but it was tough to watch. It felt as if the Dynasty guys were playing together for the very first time. No synergy, no communication. You'd think that a Gesture Winston would be very beneficial, right? It was sad to see him be useless on a signature hero. He'd just dive in and die immediately sometimes. If your whole team appears to be lacking, then there are some serious problems. The Dynasty needed more time. 1 week was not nearly enough to whip them into ideal form for this meta. Their opponents had a far better grasp on how to play it, and it shows with the final scores. I mean, the Charge game was literally the shortest match in league history, for crying out loud. That match was even a bigger slaughter than Florida versus Boston. At least Boston managed to get a point in their game. Seoul had zeros across the board for every single map. So those are three of the major moments where I saw hero pools completely destroy a team that we consider to be good or great. If you have any other good examples of hero pools taking this kind of effect, then tell me about it down in the comment section. I'd love to talk about it. So far, we've been talking a lot about the negative outcomes, so let's move into the positives now. In some cases, hero pools open up the door for some truly excellent matches. Sometimes a team not doing well because of a certain meta can be a blessing in disguise. If they are still decent and don't fall apart like Seoul did, for example, then you could see them play a hard-fought game against a team you consider to be weaker than them. The same thing applies for those times when the teams playing each other either look solid together, or both of them have no idea what they're doing, for that matter. It's not all that bad in the world of hero pools in some light. This system has given us some of the best games of the season. Look at any of the Philly vs. Paris games, or how about NYXL vs. Shanghai? Absolute masterpieces. Some of the highest quality gameplay you'll see these days. But what else might constitute as a reason behind hero pools generating a more competitive environment besides lack of preparation, knowledge, and comfort? Well, that brings me into my second talking point of this video, which is the regular season being transitioned into a completely virtual environment. The coronavirus pandemic has forced us to change the way we live day to day, and this includes the esports teams we support. Not only does it affect their overall mood and the ways in which they can spend their off time like anybody else, but it changes the ways in which they play the game. It doesn't take a genius to realize that playing matches online are going to feel completely different compared to LAN. Whether it's a good thing or a bad thing depends on the person. For the people who it positively affects, they don't have to be concerned about nerves and stage fright. Some people don't play as well on LAN because of the simple fact that they're nervous. The term scrim god didn't just appear out of nowhere, you know. The lack of pressure can sometimes be the difference maker between being a really good player and just a decent one. But at the same time, not playing on stage is going to hurt others. Some teams simply play better when they're on stage, it's a given fact. The crowd gives them that energy and extra motivation to play like madmen. Some players will straight up tell you that it's harder to take the game seriously in this type of online environment. It feels more like scrims. They're playing from the comfort of their own home, so it feels more casual. Some people really do thrive off of being able to play in front of other people. They are entertainers after all. Like with any other pro sports, that's partially what you do it for. You want to put on a good showing for the spectators and those who support you. It feels less like a pro sports game and more like a casual day of practice. And if you want to add on to the environment feeling lackluster, not all teams play together in the same room. Some of them are social distancing, or they're living too far apart from one another. I believe it was McGravy who said on his Twitter that it's been over a month since he's seen some of the faces of his teammates. That is really sad, and it can take a toll on a player's mental. That's part of what makes playing for a team so great. You build a lot of fantastic memories together. In a lot of cases, you become friends with these people. You get close to each other and establish a sense of brotherhood with one another. A team like the Valiant, just to name an example, will really feel the pain from something like this. Their players and coaches are so close with one another, which in turn can contribute to them not being in the ideal mental state. And as we've seen in the past from a lot of different people, if your heart is not completely in it, you are not going to play at your best. This in turn could lead to specific teams slipping up against someone who you'd expect them to defeat with relative ease. There's so many ways where this whole social distancing thing changes how players approach the game. Mentally, this whole pandemic is pretty draining and they already deal with that enough as it is. You need some crazy mental fortitude for this type of stuff. With that said, I think that pretty much concludes my feelings on how hero pools and the regular season being strictly online affects the competitive nature of the Overwatch League. If you enjoyed this discussion and you want to see more, then be sure to like, comment, and subscribe. If you're interested in supporting me beyond my content alone, then consider following me on Twitter at ATPOverwatch, joining my Discord server through the link in the description, and purchasing a channel membership for some exclusive perks. And as always, thanks so much for watching today's video. I really do appreciate it. And until next time, this is ATP, signing out. Peace.